Well, good evening. My name is John Gallen, and I'm the director of the NIH Clinical Center, and it's my distinct privilege to welcome you tonight to our beginning of this course on Introduction to the Principles and Practices of Clinical Research. And I especially want to welcome our guests from 11 institutions who are coming by television live. And if we could start off with the first introductory slides for the course, if you have them, not this set. Okay, so I thought I would tell you a little bit about who's really enrolled in this course. This is going to be a special year for us because we have more people participating in this course than ever before. Enrolled here at NIH are 551 people. There are 82 remote sites, 11 of whom are coming in live. For an additional 3,520 people taking this course, for a total of 4,071 for this particular course this year. So I'm thrilled, as are the entire faculty, thrilled that you're all participating. Dr. Fred Ognebeni, who's been a partner with me on this course for years and is standing up in the back of the room, is excited. As is Dr. Laura Lee Johnson, who you'll be meeting, who's helped us coordinate this course this year. So of our participating off-campus sites, 41 U.S. Remote sites, we have 25 new ones who've never participated before, and we have 41 international remote sites. And 31 of those are new. So the total number of participating remote sites is 82. A few administrative pointers for this course. We have a course textbook titled Principles and Practice of Clinical Research, which is now in its third edition. You can get this online, or you can get it at the NIH FAES bookstore, which, as you all know, is now in a new location on the corridor on the way to the large Missouri Theater. Handouts will be posted on the course website, which is indicated on this slide, at https://ipppcr.nihtraining.com/login.php. So you should be going to that site to get copies of material that's being distributed. We ask you to please fill out, after each talk, lecture evaluations, and there'll be a link that will appear on the course website following the lecture. We value those feedbacks tremendously because we hand them summarize them and give them to the speakers, gives them an opportunity to improve, and we also look at them critically each year to decide whether faculty needs to be changed. So give us your good comments and your critical comments, and they will help us try to sustain this course at a very high level long time into the future. A video archive is made of each talk, and that's posted within 48 hours following a presentation. So if you miss a talk for some reason, you can still get it by going to the archive. If you have questions that you don't get answered in the live presentation, they can be submitted to the course coordinator, Mr. Daniel McAnally, at daniel.mcanally@nih.gov, and those are then dealt with. At the end of the course, we give an exam, and it's posted on the course website. So what that means is it's an open book exam. You take it, and then you submit it, And if you get a 75% or better score, you will get a certificate. Any questions regarding the course can also be brought to our attention by calling the telephone number at the bottom of this slide, 301-496-9425. One of the things we have on the website is a discussion board feature, which gives you an opportunity to look at the 2014 video and handout archive, and you can see you'll get those for each talk. So let me now just quickly review with you the content of this course so you'll have an overview. It's set up in a group of modules. The first module, which we're starting tonight, is called, it's actually starting at the next talk, Study Design and Statistics, Choosing a Research Question and Implications for Efficient Clinical Trials, Clinical Research from the Patient's Perspective, Study Participant Selection, Overview of Clinical Study Design, Measures. You have all this material in your handout, so I'm not going to read this slide in detail, but it gives you a sense of Module 1, Study Design and Statistics. Module 2 is Ethical, Legal, and Regulatory Considerations, including Ethical Principles in Clinical Research, the FDA Product Regulation, Institutional Review Boards. There's a mock IRB session, which is very popular in the past, and then Research with Vulnerable Participants. Module 3 is Preparing and Monitoring Clinical Studies, and includes such things as Data and Safety Monitoring Committees, Protocol Development, etc., as shown on this slide. Module 4 are some miscellaneous topics, including technology transfer, scientific conduct, health disparities research, community based participatory research, dissemination and implementation research. So lectures to be viewed on the archives, that is, we're not having a live presentation this year, but rather we feel that the prior year's presentation will cover the material very well, includes inclusion of women and minorities in clinical trials, quality of life, the clinical researcher and the media, legal issues in clinical research, and development of manuals of operating procedures. So those are the main topics of the course, and spend a little time thumbing through the outline, and we encourage you to read the materials that are distributed. And of course, today you can just pick up the newspaper every day and read some topic related to clinical research with no effort, and I'm sure generate your own questions and answers, and we hope you'll bring those issues that are high on your mind to our attention during the course or privately when the faculty are available to speak with you. And don't hesitate to call or email the faculty if you have a thought or a question. We will be responsive, or let me know and I'll make sure they're responsive. So my lecture is the first one, and we hope it's something that will be able to set a little bit of perspective of what we're all talking about. This is a hobby that I have, and it's the history of clinical research. And what I tried to do is to show you that clinical research is really global. It's something that cultures have been thinking about and working on for thousands of years. And I'm going to try to cover the various cultures, but undoubtedly I missed somebody. So if I missed your favorite culture, let me know, and I'll try to fix it next time. The first chapter in this book that we have will address this in some detail. So let me start off by giving you a definition for clinical research. And the definition that I have selected is the NIH definition. And it's now pretty old. It was created in 1996 by a special committee that the then director of NIH, Harold Varmus, established. And he asked Dr. David Nathan from Harvard University to lead a panel. And they spent quite a bit of time thinking about this. And here it is reduced to one slide. It's three major categories. The first is patient-oriented research, which is has more words than any of the others. But let me read to you. Research conducted with human subjects or on material of human origin, such as tissues, specimens, and cognitive phenomena, for which an investigator or a colleague directly interacts with human subjects and includes development of new technologies, mechanisms of human disease, therapeutic interventions, and clinical trials. The second broad category is epidemiologic and behavioral studies. And the third is outcomes research and health services research. And that relates to, you know, getting things out into clinical practice and things that are population-based, and it also relates to policy issues for the leaders of the world. So I like to think of one quote from Isaac Newton that sort of just sets the framework. Who you all have undoubtedly heard of Isaac Newton. And in 1676, he wrote, "If I have seen a little further, it is by standing on the shoulders of giants." And that's true for this whole sets the framework. Who you all have undoubtedly heard of Isaac Newton. And in 1676, he wrote, "If I have seen a little further, it is by standing on the shoulders of giants." And that's true for this whole business of clinical research. So as you think about where we're at, where we're going, what you want to do in your world, with your time in this world, in clinical research, you're undoubtedly building on something someone else had started. So where did it all start? Well, we don't know, but I can tell you it's years ago. And one early beginning was Imhotep, who was from ancient Egypt, and in he lived around 2850 BC. And he was a known scribe, a chief lector, a priest, an architect, an astronomer, a magician. Magic and medicine were really integrated, and he diagnosed and treated over 200 diseases. He performed surgery and practiced medicines from plants and knew the position and function of the vital organs, and he even talked about something which amounts to circulation of the blood system. So that was 2850 BC. Not too far in time from that was the beginning of ancient Chinese medicine, and the Emperor Qianlong experimented with poisons and classified medical plants, and he is reputed to have eaten ...365 medicinal plants over the course of his life, turned green and died. So just so you see a connection, and every now and then I'm going to show you a connection between the ancient and the modern. At about that same time in the Ning Chang described several symptoms of malaria. And the ginkgo plant, which is Artemisia annua, was described in the medical treatise. 52 remedies found in the Mwangju tomb. In 340 AD, the anti-fever properties of ginkgo first described by Zhihang in the East Jing dynasty. And that active ingredient in Yanghai was isolated by the Chinese scientist Professor Tu Yu in 1971, whose picture is shown here. And that was the development of artemisinin, the very important anti-malarial, which has had a huge impact on modern day treatment of malaria. And she won the Lasker Award in 2011 for this discovery. So a connectivity between ancient Chinese herbal medicine and modern day medicine. So the founder of surgery, some attribute to an Indian named Sushruta, who resided in the court of the Gupta kings around 600 BC. Although the precise dates are not clear. And he wrote medical texts about surgery, and his most famous, Sushruta Samhita, is an encyclopedia of medical learning. And he counted 300 bones in the human body. Who knows how many bones we say are in the human body today? Doesn't somebody have an idea? Come on. What? Didn't hear you. 360. Probably closer to 325, but that's not bad. And it really depends on when you start counting, because if you count at birth, there are more bones, and then they fuse. So like in the skull, there's a whole bunch of bones that fuse. So the point is that Sushruta was remarkably accurate back then. He also talked about the importance of, we call it sterilization. He didn't obviously know that word, but he talked about the importance of cleanliness and cleaning wounds. And he also discussed instruments to use in surgery and argued that the hand was the best instrument you could come up with. So one clinical trial that goes way back was in the Old Testament of the Bible in the book of David, which was written about 530 BC. The book of Daniel. So Daniel was captured by, and his couple of his friends were captured by Persians, and they were told that they had to eat the king's rich food, which they didn't want to do because it was not kosher and it was against their religion. So Daniel said to the steward, who was sort of their enslaver, he said, "Test your servants for 10 days. Let us be given vegetables to eat and water to drink, just vegetables and water. Then let our appearance and the appearance of the youths who eat the king's rich food be observed by you, and according to what you see, deal with your servants." So he basically said, set up a clinical trial, rich food versus vegetables and water. And so he hearkened to them in this matter and tested them for 10 days. At the end of 10 days, it was seen that they were better in appearance and fatter in flesh than the youths who ate the king's rich food. So the steward took away their rich food and the wine they were to drink and gave them vegetables. So this was maybe the first clinical trial with no informed consent. So Hippocrates was undoubtedly one of the great ancient physicians, who was born about 460 BC and died about 370 BC. And you know about the Hippocratic method. And he said a great part of the art of medicine, and he used the word art, is to be able to observe. And you can get from the Library of Medicine here on the NIH campus copies of these short descriptions that Hippocrates wrote. And let me read one to you. The description of pulmonary edema. He said, "Water accumulates, the patient has fever and cough, the respiration is fast, the feet become edematous, the nails appear curved, i.e. clubbed, and the patient suffers as if he has pus inside, only less severe and more protracted. One can recognize that it is not pus, but water. If you put your ear against the chest, you can hear it seethe inside like sour wine." So this is Hippocrates writing about a clinical setting, and he wrote many, I think a couple of hundred. So Hippocrates' accomplishments included dissociating medicine from theology and philosophy, establishing the science of medicine, and providing physicians with the highest moral inspiration they have, the Hippocratic Oath. He also recognized the importance of wound management. And he wrote, "If water was used for irrigation of a wound, it had to be very pure or boiled, and the hands and nails of the operator were to be cleansed." So just think about when he wrote that. It's pretty amazing. So he didn't know anything about infectious diseases, but he knew enough to say this. Iranian medicine made some remarkable accomplishments. Al-Razi and Ibn Sina, and Razi lived from about 865 to 925. He discovered the use of alcohol as an antiseptic. Now, you could argue Hippocrates did, because he said you pour wine over a wound to clean it, but Razi elaborated on that. His contributions to medicine included also contributions to alchemy and philosophy, and he's most known for his first treatise on pediatrics, and he recorded these observations of his in 184 books and articles. So if you wrote and you recorded what you were doing and you did a few good things, you know, maybe that's how you became famous. But it's amazing that, imagine what it took to write 184 books in those days. They didn't have computers. Sina, or Avencia, who lived from 973 to 1037, was a leader in pharmacy and philosophy of medicine and pharmacology. And he wrote the Canon of Medicine, which was one of the most important books written, if you want to think of the history of clinical research. And it was the main European medical textbook of the 14th and the 16th century. And it contains the first known treatise on clinical trials, providing a foundation for systematic approach to drug testing. And I just want to give you 10 things that he said in that, or 7 things in that book. 7 conditions for experimentation of a drug. He wrote, a drug must be pure before you test it. A drug must be tested for only one condition at a time. Drugs must be tested in contradictory states, i.e. Well, that's what he wrote. The strength of a drug must be proportionate to severity of diseases. Time of therapeutic effect must be considered. A drug must be observed for continued action. And finally, a drug must be tested in humans before judgment. So think when this was written and these core principles have, many of them have stood up to today. So I include Leonardo da Vinci, you know, I have this liberty of advancing by 500 or 1,000 years at a time as I see fit. I include him as a clinical investigator. He was the great Italian who was born near Florence. And the reason I include him, and by the way, this is the only likeness of him that exists. This is a self-portrait that Da Vinci did. Because of his anatomy, he was really one of the beginning people to record anatomical structures. And I have this great book at home of Da Vinci's drawings, and it's just one after another, and they're remarkably accurate and precise. Let me go on to tell you a little bit about the history of the microscope, which is so widely used. Glass was invented by the Romans in the first century AD, and they recognized that when it's thicker in the middle than on the edges, it could magnify. In the 13th century, eyeglasses were invented, first in Germany, around 1286. In 1590, Zachariah Janssen and son Hahn invented the first microscope by taking two pieces of glass that were magnifying glasses and putting them in a tube and showing that if you put one on top of the other, you'd get amplified magnification. This was the first compound microscope. Galileo modified it so that you could have a way of focusing something. But it was really Leeuwenhoek, who lived from 1632 to 1723, who made the microscope, or applied the microscope to study biological systems. He actually worked in a dry goods store counting threads in woven cloth, so he was very interested in developing good magnification so he could accurately count these threads. And he figured out that if you made the center of the glass thicker and the edges thinner, you could greatly amplify your magnification. So he made these small lenses, and they resulted in 270 power magnification. And what I have here in the bottom is something I bought this weekend. I was up in a little town in Maine, and I walked into a bookstore called the Old Professor's Bookstore. And there I saw this thing on the bottom, which I saw from, recognized because I had that old etching with Leeuwenhoek holding his microscope. And this was a facsimile of his microscope. And maybe you want to come up to my office, I'll show it to you. But what Leeuwenhoek did is, in the middle of this, in the top at left of this microscope, there's a little lens, and there's like a needle, and you put your sample on the needle, and then you could, it's actually a three-way stage. You can move the specimen right to left or up to down and tilt it, and you look through the other side, and it really works. I mean, I tried it out. You can, it's amazing. So he described bacteria, yeast, sperm, striated muscle, the crystalline lens, red cells, and other things. And although he worked in looking at woven cloth, he rapidly became a very famous scientist without any education in the sciences, and became a member of the Royal Academy of Sciences in England. And pretty cool. So let me now tell you about William Harvey, who defined the circulatory system with precision in 15, he lived from 1578 to 1657, and wrote the following passage, which is so applicable to what we do here at the NIH Clinical Center, where half of our patients, or almost half, have a rare disease. And we probably see more patients with rare diseases than anywhere in the world. What Harvey wrote is that nature is nowhere accustomed more openly to display her secret mysteries than in cases where she shows traces of her workings apart from the beaten path. Nor is there any better way to advance the proper practice of medicine than to give our minds to the discovery of the usual law of nature by the careful investigation of cases of rarer forms of disease. This hits my heart since I've spent my life studying rare diseases, and I think this is a great passage from 1657. So we think we're so clever studying these rare diseases. Well, Harvey recognized it back then. Christopher Wren lived about the same time, from 1632 to 1723. And I'm sure you remember him as a great architect, but he was much more than an architect. He did the first intravenous injections in dogs. And he also invented the tools for the first transfusion. What he did is he took a dog bladder and the urethra, and he used it sort of like a funnel. And then he put a needle, which he made out of sterling silver, at the end. And he poured opium into the bladder and fused it into dogs and studied the effects of opium on dogs. And then he worked with two of his buddies, which I thought Richard Lauer and Edmund King, who are listed here. and they did the first transfusion in humans in 1667 of blood, and it was luck that they had compatible blood types, and the patient who was bleeding got better. So that was the first transfusion. So Christopher Wren did that while he was also doing anatomical drawings. Here is a drawing that he did of the Circle of Willis for a friend of his who was a neurologist. In addition to, you know, surveying and machines to lift water, military devices to defend cities, et cetera. So in those days, you could be everything. And he was did an awful lot in his life. Perhaps the first clinical trial that approaches what we consider more of a modern clinical trial was done by James Lind, who worked on scurvy, because this was a major health problem in the British Navy in the 1700s, and James Lind was in the British Navy. At the time, William Harvey had recommended lemons to treat scurvy, but had argued that the therapeutic effect was a result of the acid in the fruit. And Lind conducted a clinical trial in 1747 to assess the utility of three therapies for scurvy. So he took 12 sailors with classical scurvy and divided them into six groups of two each, all given identical diets, which were supplemented with either the following: vinegar, dilute sulfuric acid, cider, seawater, nutmeg, garlic, and horseradish mixture, or two oranges and one lemon daily. And these are his data. Okay, so all of the regimens failed, except for citrus fruit, where two out of two people got better. None of this was significant, and yet he was right, and he became famous, and he published this paper describing this. So he worked on an important problem of the day, and he was right, and he did a clinical trial of comparing a number of different conditions for treatment. I'd like to tell you a little bit about the story of smallpox. By the way, my background is infectious diseases and immunology, so there's going to be some bias in what I select here to show you. Smallpox is an ancient disease. So as far as we now know, Al-Razi first described smallpox about 900 AD. In the 11th century, protective measures for smallpox existed, particularly in the Orient. Putting scabs from smallpox pustules in the nostrils of a healthy person. So the risk was obviously a certain percentage of those people got smallpox, but some people were actually protected. People wore the clothing of someone who had the disease. Again, it seemed to be protective for some people. And they ingested powdered fleas from infected cows, who probably had cowpox and not smallpox. And that may have perceived the relationships of cowpox to smallpox and the eventual effective vaccine. In the 1700s, around 1720, variolation was practiced in Africa, China, and India. And that was sort of like putting pus in the nostrils. But here you would take a scab from someone who had smallpox, cut it, and then lance it, and then take the pus inside it and inoculate it into the skin of a healthy person. In 1721, Lady Mary Worley Montague, the wife of the British ambassador, observed inoculation of this sort in Constantinople, and she introduced the practice of variolation in London and inoculated her own two children. And on the basis of this, a London smallpox inoculation hospital was founded in 1745. Benjamin Jesty, who lived from 1736 to 1816, was a farmer who lived in the village of Yetminster in North Dorset, United Kingdom. And he was convinced milkmaids who contracted cowpox were protected from smallpox. And in 1774, he inoculated himself, his wife, and his two sons with cowpox lymph from the underside of the cow udder. And in 1805, he publicly inoculated son Robert with live smallpox to demonstrate that it was effective. And it was. So imagine doing that to your son. So Jesty gets very little credit. There's actually a picture of him shown here in England. But he is not credited with developing the smallpox vaccination. Edward Jenner is. And the reason is because Edward Jenner did a big clinical trial. So he took the cowpox pus from the udders of cows, and he inoculated a whole number of subjects and showed that they were protected from getting cowpox. And as soon as he finished that study, it was widely adopted throughout the world as the way to prevent cowpox, probably the first vaccine, and maybe you could argue the beginning of the pharmaceutical industry. Now, there is a little vignette I wanted to tell you about two things that happened in the United States. First of all, Lord Jeffrey Amherst, for whom my college is named, wasn't all such a good guy. And in the French and Indian War in 1763, the Pontiac Rebellion, he gave blankets to the Indians with infected with smallpox and basically founded biological warfare. On the positive side, George Washington was amazing and probably saved the Continental Army by varolation, that is, taking pus from infected patients and putting it into his soldiers to protect the Continental Army. And what happened was, in 1775 to 1776, the U.S. Continental Army in our revolution was fighting the British, and the British had an epidemic of smallpox. And they were much larger in numbers than the Continental Army, and Washington realized that if his soldiers got smallpox, it would be over. We would lose. And so he convinced John Adams that this was important. And John Adams went to the Continental Congress, and on July 3, 1776, the day before the Declaration of Independence was signed, the Continental Army gave George Washington permission to do inoculation of the army with this variolation. And it's thought that that saved the Continental Army and enabled the colonies to continue fighting. So now I'll end with going to a modern era, more modern, and just point out that smallpox is now eradicated, maybe the only infectious disease on Earth to be wiped out. And that was led by D.A. Henderson, who headed the World Health Organization's global smallpox eradication campaign that started in 1966. In India, he was in India during one of the largest epidemics of the 20th century, and he initiated global immunization program, and the last case of smallpox was in Somalia in 1977, but it wasn't until 1980 that the World Health Organization was confident enough to say it was completely eradicated. So that gives you a sense of smallpox from the early days to its eradication, except for the vials that were found at NIH last summer. A few comments about genetics. You all know about Gregor Mendel, who did experiments in plant hybridization and led to the then new theory of inheritance, and describing that the inherited element was a particulate element, and that genetic factors came in pairs, and that genes are on chromosomes and pass from parents to offspring during sexual reproduction. One of the things that I got criticized for when I first started giving this talk was never mentioning any women. So I'm going to start mentioning women and showing you how critical they've been, although they really didn't come on the scene until the beginning of the 1900s. And one of those great women was Barbara McClintock, who was an American scientist and one of the world's most distinguished cytogenetics, and did groundbreaking research in developing the technique for visualizing maize chromosomes and used microscopic analysis to demonstrate many fundamental genetic principles, and among those discovering transposition and using it to demonstrate that genes are responsible for turning physical characteristics on and off. And she won the Nobel Prize in 1983 for her discovery of mobile genetic elements. Now, Charles Darwin, I bring up to in this talk about the history of clinical research for two reasons. First is his book, The Origin of the Species, and his theory of evolution and natural selection, providing a mechanistic explanation for adaptation based on natural laws, not on supernatural or religious actions. And you could argue nothing in biology makes sense without evolution. But the other reason I bring this up is because he created, as far as I can determine, the first tissue bank. And he wrote in meticulous detail records about the tissues that he banked. And he had no idea the value that this tissue bank might have years later. So some of you may have seen that there's some extinct birds that people have been able to go to his tissue bank and take the genes and put them into closely related species, and they're trying to resuscitate lost species. So as we sit and talk about banking human tissue and creating biorepositories and think about, you have to think about things that we have no idea what these tissue banks might be used for 100 years from now. And as we talk about informed consent, which I'll get to a little later, and questions that you need to address to the people who donate these tissues, remember Charles Darwin, you know. He just did it because he thought it was important and interesting. And of course, he didn't get tissue from humans, but he set a precedent. So epidemiology is a critical part of clinical research. It's one of those three components of the definition. Clinical research applying epidemiology, I would think the father is John Snow, who was born in York, England in 1813. And he was a physician. He was an anesthesiologist, but a real medical hygiene pioneer, and is the father of modern epidemiology for the work he did on a cholera outbreak in Soho, England in 1854. And what he did is he did this spot map, as it's called, where he took a map of a region in Soho where there was clearly big problems with cholera, and he just put a dot where every patient was who got cholera on his map, where they lived. And he noted that it surrounded a water pump, which is in the center of this pink area on the slide. And he was able to conclude that that water pump was important. And he went to the folks in York and said, if you close that pump, you'll stop the epidemic. And so they closed the pump, and sure enough, the cholera disappeared. But the people who lived there were very unhappy because they now had to walk a great distance to get their water. And so they opened it, and of course, the epidemic came back, and then they closed it again. So this was the first application of a statistical approach to analyze a clinical problem in a community and to draw a conclusion that was right. And for that reason, he's considered the father of modern epidemiology. Washing hands. So I already told you that Sushruta advocated sterilization of wounds and Hippocrates promoted clean hands for wound management. But the person who really was maybe made the most important observation of public health in the 1800s was Semmelweis, Ignaz Semmelweis, who was born in Budapest, Hungary. And it's a fabulous story, so let me tell you about it. And its application today is very real. Just a few years ago, a year and a half ago, we had a multi-drug-resistant Klebsiella infection in this hospital at the clinical center. 7 patients died, and the main reason people died, in my opinion, was failure to wash hands properly. So, Semmelweis studied puerperal sepsis in Vienna over the protestations of his chief. He noted that the sepsis rate was 3 times higher in Division 1 of his hospital than in Division 2. The divisions were identical except medical students worked in Division 1 and midwives in Division 2. Death of a friend following infection of an autopsy-related wound led to his primary hypothesis that the infection was transported from the autopsy room to uninfected patients by the students. So, he made the students wash their hands in chlorinated lime solution, and the basin that he used is still available, shown in the right. And when he did that, the mortality rate dropped from 18.3% to 1.3% per year. And in some months in 1848, it was zero. So these are the data that he had, and it's mortality rates on the y-axis in the different months of the years shown, the yellow line. You can see that it would go up and down, and these were women who were giving birth. The red arrows when they started washing their hands, and it was dramatic. You didn't need fancy statistics, but nobody believed them. His chief in particular did not believe him, and he fired him a year later. So he was pretty depressed, and he moved back to Budapest, Hungary, where he repeated his earlier experiment and got the same results. And they didn't believe him. He submitted his paper for publication, and it was rejected. So he paid to have his paper, The Etiology, Understanding, and Prevention of Puerperal Sepsis. He got it finally published at his expense in the Vienna Medical Journal. And he got so depressed, he went crazy and had to be admitted to a sane asylum, where he died because he cut his foot on the edge of a bed with a disease just like puerperal sepsis. So talking about bad things. But he believed in what he was doing. And it was because of an anesthesiologist at Massachusetts General Hospital, Oliver Wendell Holmes Sr., the father of the great Supreme Court justice in the United States, who was an anesthesiologist, who knew about Semmelweis's work, who went all over the country advocating the importance of washing hands, that in this country, the United States, it became a established approach for proper health care. And Semmelweis became famous. Joseph Lister, who lived from 1827 to 1912, did careful trials on antiseptics, and it was particularly in the surgical setting where he would spray antiseptics across the wound, and he was able to show a huge decrease in infection rate in the hospital setting, in the surgery setting, doing such an approach. If you ever heard of Listerine, it's named for Joseph Lister. So a few comments about surgery. John Hunter, some people consider to be the father of modern surgery. He lived from 1728 to 1793. He was Scottish. He was a Scottish anatomist and a surgeon. He was the younger brother. His older brother was a really famous surgeon who moved to London. And his mother didn't know what to do with him, so he sent him to work with his brother. And his brother decided that, well, go rob graves of the cadavers and we'll teach anatomy. And that's what he did. So his job was he'd follow funeral processions, and then when everybody left at night, he'd dig up the grave, take the corpse back to his place, and they would teach anatomy for profit. I won't comment on that. But he, in that process, he became a phenomenal surgeon. He got very skilled at anatomy and then at techniques, and he really did some wonderful procedures. He also did something that is obviously not acceptable today. He was interested in determining the nature of venereal disease, and he inoculated himself with a infected person who had syphilis, and he got syphilis, and he went into heart failure because it damaged his heart valve. There's a book called The Knife Man, which I recommend if you want to read a fun book about surgery. Okay, let's spend a few minutes talking about the birth of the pharmaceutical industry, which I already told you about the Jenner and the smallpox vaccine. But it's hard to know when it began, but I'll show you a few people who've clearly made important contributions. Claude Bernard, who lived from 1813 to 1878, was French, and he made a lot of contributions, including recognizing that the pancreas released important enzymes responsible for digestion. He recognized the glycogenic function of the liver. He also recognized the vasomotor system as a vasodilator and vasoconstricted nerves, and he also demonstrated the importance of curare, and that was an early important drug. Virchow, the great pathologist from Poland, described leukemia, and the reason I put him here in the early founders of pharmaceutical industries is because he wrote omnis cellula acellula, meaning every cell originates from another cell. So if you think about it, he recognized stem cells and their importance, and he made that in a paper he wrote in 1858. Other things he did was recognize pulmonary emboli and the importance of thromboses and embolization to the lungs. Now, one of my favorite historical features is Pasteur, who was also from France and lived from 1822 to 1895. And as you all know, probably he figured out the germ basis of fermentation, the germ theory of infectious diseases. He discovered staphylococci as the cause of boils. He described strep pyogenes as the cause of purple sepsis, which Semmelweis wrote about. He developed a vaccine for anthrax, which was very close to what was used in a number of years ago when we had that anthrax scare, as well as the vaccine for rabies. So that's clearly the beginning of some pharmaceutical thoughts. If you notice in this picture, his right arm is sort of just hanging on his back. He had a stroke at an early age and couldn't use his right arm. Despite that, he was able to do all his great scientific lab work. Koch, Robert Koch, who was German, he introduced the Petri dish and the use of blood agar and pore plates to culture bacteria. He described anthrax before Pasteur developed a vaccine in 1872. He was the first person to culture tuberculosis, and he developed the TB skin test, very similar to the DPT skin test, which was used throughout the world. He described waterborne epidemics. He developed his Koch postulates. And in 1905, he was awarded the Nobel Prize for his investigations and discoveries in relationship to tuberculosis. Emil von Behring, also German, discovered antibodies, particular diphtheria antitoxin, and he did the first use of passive immunization, which is being used today in patients with Ebola, although we don't know if it works, but it's clearly being used. He won the first Nobel Prize in 1901. It would have gone to Pasteur, but Pasteur had died, and they decided right from the beginning not to give it posthumously. He won it for his work on serum therapy, especially its application against diphtheria. Paul Ehrlich is one of my real heroes. He, too, was Polish. As a medical student, he described eosinophils. He developed a stain called eosin so you could see these cells in the blood. He described the whole complement pathway in humoral immunity, and he indeed shared the Nobel Prize with a guy named Metchnikoff, who defined cellular immunity. But I show him here because he developed the first treatment of syphilis. He worked with his technician, shown in this wood cutting, Sashiro Hata, to develop a drug that was first called salvarsin, which Hoaxed Pharmaceuticals developed, which was an arsenobenzene that was 32% arsenic and toxic. Later, he developed NEO, or new salvarsin, which he called compound 914, which was less toxic, and it worked against syphilis. And he coined the term magic bullet. He said, we must search for magic bullets. We must strike the parasites and the parasites only, if possible. And to do this, we must learn to aim with chemical substances. So this was the beginning of the idea of antibiotics. Now, if you look through and say, when was the first commercial antibiotic made? It was actually made by a guy named René Debose, who worked at the Rockefeller University and developed the first antibiotic called gramicidin in 1939. And he was analyzing the mode of action of antibacterial agents. It has to be kept in mind that susceptible bacteria species often give rise by training themselves or making variants endowed with great resistance. And in some cases, the resistance may be due to changes in the metabolic behavior and may result from a change of cell permeability. So he began to think of the mechanism of action of antibiotics and was thinking of gramicidin, and that actually became a skin ointment antibiotic in 1939. Around the same time, Fleming did his famous work in 1928 when he was working on influenza virus, and he observed that a mold on a staph culture plate with a bacterial free circle surrounding it, and that was due to what he called penicillin, and that really began the major effort in the pharmaceutical industry, and he got the Nobel Prize in 1945. Another remarkable story in the history of the pharmaceutical industry is the insulin story. In 1921, material extracted from the islets of Langerhans, called insulin from Latin for island, was given to diabetic dogs resulting in who had very high blood pressures, and these were lowered by Banting and Best. And they were doing it while their boss was away on a summer vacation, a guy named McLeod. Within 6 weeks, this material they purified was given to a 14-year-old boy dying of diabetes after they had given it to these dogs. And it worked. It lowered blood sugar and cleared the urine of sugars and other signs of disease. So that was the beginning of insulin and diabetes. And in 1922, Banting and Best published a paper on their discovery. And in 1923, a year later, the Nobel Prize was awarded to Banting and McLeod. McLeod had been away on his summer vacation while all this was done. And Best, who was a technician and wasn't considered to be high enough up in the hierarchy, did not get the Nobel Prize, although they shared their money with him. So it's one of those cruel stories about science, but a great discovery. And we can't talk about the pharmaceutical industry without talking about a disease which was the first disease for which there was a molecular basis, namely sickle cell anemia, discovered by Linus Pauling when he described he described his research on the nature of the chemical bond and its application to the elucidation of structure of complex substances based on hemoglobin and its abnormality in sickle cell. Won the Nobel Prize for that, and then he won it singly, all by himself, in 1954. And in 1962, he won a second Nobel Prize in a totally unrelated area, the Peace Prize, for his opposition to weapons of mass destruction. But we still haven't a good drug, for treating sickle cell anemia, and that's currently being pursued actively here at the NIH, as well as elsewhere. Polio. Those of you who are my age grew up in the era of polio and the fear that that instilled. In 1954, the Nobel Prize was shared by Joseph Enders, Thomas Weller, and Frederick Robbins for their work figuring out how to culture the Nobel Prize. Salk and Sabin never won the Nobel Prize. It was for the basic science that enabled them to develop their vaccines. So it was Salk who developed the first inactivated polio vaccine, where he took the virus, treated it with formaldehyde, inactivated it, and then showed that you could take that inactivated virus and use it as a vaccine, and it worked. And they were doing a trial in 1.8 million children. And it seemed to work, but there was an error. There was a company called Cutter who was developing it. And there was an error made in the dose of formaldehyde needed to inactivate the vaccine. And they gave a bunch of vaccines to children without fully inactivating it. And there were about 170 children who went on to get polio from the vaccine. And that was a live virus, polio, so scarier was that it was transmitted to other members of the community in the classroom. And there was big concern that this vaccine was going to result in a new form of polio that was even going to be worse than the natural virus. So they took it all off the shelf. They stopped using the Salk vaccine. It took them a while to figure out what the problem was. Eventually, they corrected it, and the vaccine was used widely. But it was a tragic error. And what happened was they extrapolated the amount of formaldehyde needed from a dose response curve that had some data points, but not all the data points, going to the lowest levels. And they thought it was a straight line. It wasn't a straight line. It had a curve to it. And so they used the wrong dose. And it was a real tragedy. But they still developed a good vaccine that eventually was shown to work. But it was Albert Sabin who made what I consider maybe a perfect vaccine. This was the oral vaccine that you all know about. And the reason I think of it as perfect is because they say if you inoculated one child in a classroom, the whole classroom was inoculated because it was transmitted by the oral route, like a cold, and everybody got the vaccine version of the polio, which was not harmful. And so people were hopeful that you could eradicate polio. Hasn't worked, unlike smallpox. It still exists in Nigeria and Pakistan and in India. Still suspicion about vaccinating people. And the thing about polio, unlike smallpox, it's a vector that it lives in vectors. It lives in streams. And if you don't continually take the vaccine, it will come back. That's why children are in this country continue to get vaccinated. So let me just say a few things about some women in research. I like to refer to Florence Nightingale, who was born in Italy, who was a famous nurse, but she was also a very accomplished mathematician. Her parents apparently didn't think a lady should be doing mathematics, so it was sort of hidden, and she became a nurse. But she couldn't resist, and she became very involved in what it takes to run a healthy hospital. And she mathematically figured out how to space beds and applied this in the Crimean War, where she worked and was able to reduce the infectious disease transmissions in the hospitals in a war setting by proper ventilation and spacing of beds. Marie Curie, you've probably heard about, who was Polish, who discovered radium with her husband, Pierre. They realized that radioactivity was an intrinsic atomic property of matter. You may not be aware that she also developed the first mobile X-ray unit in World War I for the French Army, taking advantage of the effects of radium. And she and her husband were awarded the Nobel Prize for Physics in 1903. I think he was celebrating the award and got her a piece of jewelry, was running to bring it to her, and he got hit by a horse-drawn carriage and was killed. she went on and won a second Nobel Prize in chemistry in recognition of further work in radioactivity. And her daughter, Irene Joliet Curie, was awarded the Nobel Prize for Chemistry in 1935, along with her husband, for their discovery of artificial radioactivity. So that was quite a husband, wife, daughter, son-in-law team. Talking about women, I have to mention Rosalind Yalow, who lived from 1921 to 2011, was a physicist who collaborated with Solomon Burson, who was a physician working at Mount Sinai Hospital in New York City, and they developed the radioimmune assay. He died before the Nobel Prize was given out, so he didn't receive it, but she did in 1977. And she also won the Albert Lasker Award for Basic Medical Research. And lastly, the women I'll mention is Janet Rowley, who was a geneticist, who was the first scientist to identify a chromosomal translocation as the cause of leukemia and other cancers, and discovered what's called the Philadelphia chromosome, which was implicated in certain leukemias. And she won many awards, including the National Medal of Science, the Medal of Freedom, and the Lasker Award. Now, before we get to the close of this, I want to just say a few more things. I want to tell you about some the blind studies and the placebo effect. So you'll be amazed, I think, at who did the first blinded study. It was this guy, Benjamin Franklin. So you think of him of electricity, you think of him as an ambassador to France. Well, in 1784, the King of France, while he was representing the colonies there, King Louis XVI, asked Franklin to solve a problem that he had. And the problem that King had was that his constituency was going to his park in Versailles and hugging the trees. And they said hugging the trees cured all their illnesses. And the king was embarrassed. So he said to Franklin, he says, "Is this real?" So he asked Franklin to set up a commission, which he did. He had all sorts of famous people on it, including Guillotine of the Knife. And they decided to do a study. So they each went to the Versailles and hugged the trees, and they realized they couldn't come to any conclusions. So they went back, and they got some pieces of trees and some other objects, and they brought in a couple of hundred people, and they blindfolded them, and they asked them to hold these things and said, "Do you feel better?" And of course, the answer was no conclusion. They found nothing. So, but in the process of writing this up, this single-blinded study, and it's published in this paper called Animal Magnetism, which I can give you if you're interested in reading it. It's in English. Franklin noted the placebo effect, and he wrote about that. And he said, you know, if people want to believe that something is having an effect, they'll believe it. So Franklin was the first person, to my knowledge, to do a blinded study and also the first person to describe the placebo effect. So blinding has gone on. There's a guy named Torrid Solomon who suggested a placebo control in blinded observers as a solution to investigator bias. That was hundreds of years later, in 1930. And blindfolded tests were widely used by advertisers and consumer groups in the 1930s and 1940s. Statistics, when did that get started? Well, I already told you about epidemiology, which really wasn't statistics, but this guy, Sir Ronald Almar Fisher, who lived from 1890 to 1962, is often credited with the idea of randomization, and not for its application in medicine, but rather in the agricultural setting. He studied whether rotating crops really made a difference, and he introduced application of statistics to experimental design and applied it to farming and plant fertility, and it was really a very important advance. He also developed the analysis of variance, which you'll hear about in great detail in coming talks. The first application of statistics to a clinical trial, I believe, was by Sir Austin Bradford Hill in 1948 for his work on vancomycin really worked in tuberculosis, and that was really the first pharmacologic treatment for TB. What about ethics? You're going to have some talks on ethics, and I have to give you a few examples of what bad ethics, and then you'll see how we got to some good ethics. One example was Hansen. So Gerhard Hansen, who was Norwegian, identified the bacterium Mycobacterium lepra as the cause of leprosy in 1874, but nobody really believed him, and to try to prove that he was really right, he did something he shouldn't have done. He took live leprosy and inoculated it into nurses without getting their consent. And sure enough, they got leprosy. So he was fired. She sued him. But he wasn't completely fired. He was removed from his top position, and he retained his role as a chief medical officer for leprosy status. But it's a clear example of what not to do. The second example of what not to do was in 1898 when Giuseppe Santarelli, who was working on yellow fever, discovered the etiologic agent as a transmissible agent. But he did it by inoculating what he anticipated was the infectious agent and not getting informed consent. And William Osler wrote or not wrote, got up and said at a national meeting, to deliberately inject a poison of known high degree of virulency into a human being unless you obtain a man's sanction is criminal. So beginning of informed consent, and that was the end of Santarelli's career, as far as I can determine, when Osler got up and said that. Informed consent, as we know it today, actually began, at least in this country, in this building, in the old hospital, in 1953, at the very first meeting of the medical board of the clinical center. And the chairman of that committee was Luther Terry, and in the minutes of that meeting, it said they considered how to provide each patient with a reasonable understanding of his role in a study project and the means for obtaining evidence of such understanding and consent. This process in the clinical center of getting consent became the basis for the congressional Kefauver-Harris amendment to the FDA Food and Drug Act, stipulating subjects must be told whether a drug is being used for investigational purposes. And then the Surgeon General of the United States adopted this to require peer review and the establishment of institutional review boards for every public health service grant, so all grants from the NIH. And that set the informed consent process and the IRBs as a requirement to get federal funding for doing research. And then in 1967, the FDA required all new drug sponsors to obtain informed consent for use of investigational drugs in humans. So you're going to hear more about this, and you're going to hear about the Nuremberg trials and other important steps, the Belmont Report, as you get into ethics. So that's my last slide, and I just wanted to end by saying to you, the history of clinical research really is a merger of diverse cultures going way back to thousands of years ago and requiring partnerships today. So just read your newspaper about Ebola if you want a dramatic example. Here at the Clinical Center, we've done the first clinical trial of a vaccine, a phase one study a couple of weeks ago. We're doing another vaccine trial. You go around the country, you all know what happened there. You know the tragedy that happened in Texas. But understanding that tragedy is undoubtedly going to help us. And it's a worldwide effort to try to overcome that disease. And we did it with AIDS. We'll probably do it with Ebola, but it will take time. So thank you very much, and I hope the course proves exciting for you. And you'll hear more current day issues starting at the next talk.
In your lecture, after looking at so many of these historical examples, what do you think is the prime driver for